guys, welcome to my channel. My name is Reading Bear and I hope you are ready for some more stories. And today, we will take a look at some new Pori Ranch content.
If you enjoyed my content, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel and post some bear emojis in the comment. And now, let's dive right into the stories.
First one is titled, Douchey Apartment Guest Gets a New Bumper. A couple years ago I was in graduate school living with my girlfriend and our one-year-old. We lived in a cheaper area of town due to my fantastic grad student salary. It was not a dangerous area, just kinda cramped. We lived in a townhouse apartment complex and had three other neighbors with a shared walkway entrance area. For the first few weeks everything was great, relatively quiet and had lots of room for low rent, $650 per month for a two halves. Until one of our neighbors started seeing a douchebag. We noticed that someone would regularly show up at about 2 a.m. with their bass cranked way up and would just chill in the parking lot while his bass got ready. Normally it doesn't bother me if it was for a short period, but he would sit for like 30 minutes and sometimes he wouldn't even be in the car but leave his music blaring with his windows down. So I decided to ask him to turn it down while in the parking lot as he has been waking our daughter, and a cranky child is not fun to deal with all day long. He usually did, but only for that visit. The next night it would be right back to the same volume like he had the memory of a goldfish. Fast forward a couple weeks of this and then I notice he starts parking right in front of the walkway during the day. Now to the average person it is clear this is not really a spot but rather a gap in the parking spaces with no parking block and with orange lines on either side to allow residents to go to and from the building without having to squeeze between cars. It is also smaller than the other spots but can still barely fit a vehicle. Now keep in mind, this is a pretty small parking lot with many extra spaces, so it's not like you save that much time or effort parking there compared to even the furthest spot. Anyway, he starts parking there 100% of the time and just starts irritating my wife and I due to the fact that it can be a tight squeeze with a car seat or with our dogs. Not to mention that this is not a spot to begin with. My solution is to park in the adjacent spot over the line so there is not enough room for his fat-assed Monte Carlo to fit. His response? He parks behind my car in the middle of the parking lot thinking he can block me in. Well, he does, and the next morning I have an important 7 a.m. meeting and lo and behold I am blocked. Thankfully I own a really cheap Saturn to get me to and from class. I got it for about $700, so it's also mostly plastic. In my early morning rage I decide to just nudge, scrape, hit his car with my car because I know he really cares about his vehicle as he is constantly cleaning and waxing it. Yet he parks in the middle of the parking lot. A fantastic crunching sound ensues as I slowly push into his bumper, then I readjust and pull out beside his vehicle, while scraping all the way down the side of it, then I leave to work. When I get to work I notice a dent on my bumper that I smacked to pop out and cleaned up some paint transfer. My plastic panels did not sustain enough damage to actually break as they just bent during contact and popped out. When I get back home the guy is in fury and is threatening to stab me and such, but I claim it wasn't me and I was able to squeeze out of the spot. So the police were called and they look at the cars and see no fresh damage on my car and say it wasn't me. The officer also tells the guy, well, what the hell did you expect when you parked in the middle of the parking lot? I also discover I was not the only one to hit his vehicle as there was another mark down the side, which to my delight, ended up being due to one of his girl's friends since she admitted to maybe bumping his car while backing out. After this incident I demanded to be let out of our lease with no penalty and with our security deposit. Thankfully the office obliged and we moved to another part of town. Added bonus. After said douche fixed his bumper and door panel, someone spray painted his white car with black spray paint, not me I swear. Next one is titled, No Means No. My friends take turns renting a vacation house for a month. I rented a large farmhouse with pool and housekeeper up the hill from a lovely beach town. 6 months out all the rooms are filled for the entire stay. My husband gets an email from his sister, my sister-in-law, Sil, saying that she and her mother, Mill, will be coming for a visit. I tell my husband all the rooms are taken and send email to Sil saying the same and give her the contact for a hotel in Beach Town. I come home to the farmhouse late one afternoon to find my Sil and Mill sitting in the living room. Great, I think, two more for dinner and no advance warning. I say that I am going up to my room to change. Two steps up the stairs, my husband says there is a change in rooms. Yeep. I get to my room to find their luggage and things all over my room. I sleep on the floor? Nah. A side note on Mill. No one ever tells her no. Our house heated to 80°F day, night when she visits in winter and 60°F in summer. All lights turned on all the time. Her food in frig, yours on counter, etc. Whatever. But after 15 years, I had enough. My vacation house, I paid for everything, my rules. I packed up their things, took luggage downstairs and put in their car. Saying nothing, went in kitchen, the stovetop is filled with pots madly bubbling. Mill cooking is the worst. Housekeeper has been unable to cook meal we had planned. I got the largest pot, poured all the food in and had the housekeeper help me take pot out, through living room, to edge of forest. Dumped it. Went back in kitchen, packed up their food, took it to their car. Went and stood in front of Sil and told her there was no room in the house and they would have to get a room in Beach Town. Turned to my husband and asked him to please escort his mother to their car. I went to the pool where all my friends were and waited. They took the next plane home. No means no. Next one is titled, Never Screw Over Your HVAC Technician. This is not my story, it's been a while since I've heard the story, but I'll try my best to get the details correct. I went to a local community college to get my HVAC certifications and the instructor was an old school, gruff, blue-collar worker type guy. He owned his own HVAC company and would teach at nights after work. Dude was working like 60 to 70 hours a week and had been doing this since the early 90s when an older guy, the first new in the industry, was taking classes from him. Anyways, onto the story. Instructor will be referred to as Joe. His company and my school are located in Orange County, California, an area with a lot of wealth. He lived out in Riverside, so housing wouldn't be as expensive, so it's a bit of a drive for him to get to his work territory. One Sunday he received a call from a woman panicking, her AC unit in her wine cellar has stopped working and needs Joe to come fix it as soon as possible because wine needs to be in a consistent temperature. I say, wine cellar, because down here we don't have basements in Southern California. Joe explains that since it is Sunday it will be a triple charge since he doesn't get to relax much working so many hours every week. She agrees as her wine collection is worth 1,000 times the cost of fixing the AC unit. Joe rushes 2 hours out to her house in Newport Beach and she shows him to her wine cellar, which is a massive room with rows and rows of expensive bottles of wine on racks. He gets to work, checking everything on the AC unit. He found it wasn't getting power and after tracking down the circuit he found that the GFI had popped. You probably have one in your bathroom by your sink, and has a button to reset it if it pops. He resets the GFI and the AC unit kicks back on. Temperature hadn't deviated too much from set point and all things are looking good. Joe explains to the lady what had happened and to be careful with liquids around the outlet since if it trips it'll take out the AC unit. He then tells her since there was no work needed she'll just have to pay the trip charge, which is $450 since it's Sunday. The customer, who we'll call Judy, was not happy about this. All you did was push a button, I could have done this myself. I'm not paying. Her and Joe go back and forth about her paying and eventually he leaves without payment. Joe isn't normally one to roll over but he's tired and wants to go relax on his day off. He drives home and relaxes trying to put her out of his mind. That would be a shitty revenge story if she didn't call back a few months later, again on a weekend. Help, my AC isn't working again. I tried pushing the button like you did and it's still not working and I don't know how to fix it. You need to come out and fix it. Joe reminds her that last time she called she stiffed him and that he would not do business with her. She begged and pleaded that she'll pay for both trips in full and this and that. After some convincing, Joe told her he would get to her as soon as possible. but since he is in Riverside, it will take at least an hour, maybe two, to get to her. She says fine and they hang up. Instead of getting into his truck, Joe cracks open a cold beer and waits. 2 hours go by and Judy calls Joe back, "Are you close? It's getting warm in the room, this is an emergency." Joe replies, "I'm almost there, traffic was pretty bad, but I should be there in 30 minutes. 30 more minutes go by and she calls back, "Are you close?" Joe, "Yes, I'm just around the corner, give me a few more minutes." By this time it's getting pretty late, close to 7 p.m. and she calls back one more time, "Where are you?" Joe responds, "Riverside." That was not what Judy wanted to hear. "What do you mean you're in Riverside? You said you'd be here, my wine is gonna be ruined." And then Joe hits here with, "You should never screw over people you rely on," and hung up on her. Most AC places don't take calls on the weekends or nights, so we assume she lost her collection, but can't know for sure. Anyways, point of the story is GFIs really only belong in the bathrooms and don't duck over people you need. Last one is titled, "Shut Down the Whole Plant." Once upon a time I got a temp job working in an office at a plant. My duties were simple, answer the phone, order basic office supplies and the like. It was monotonous, but a job is a job. Unfortunately, the plant wasn't expecting to keep me on very long. They were hoping to find a new HR representative that would also assume my duties. Since I really didn't want to lose the job, I worked my butt off learning about the company and trying to make myself indispensable. Shortly after they hired a new HR rep, my GM said he would keep me on as a temp, but as soon as he had approval from corporate he would offer me a salaried position with the company. I was thrilled. I needed health insurance for my daughter, so I dug deep and gave this company my all. Pretty soon after that, we were taken over by a larger company, and with that came changes. We had a whole new purchasing system that came with lots of codes and sub-account numbers I had to learn just to purchase anything. On the day corporate showed up to teach the managers and I how to use the system, I spent most of the meeting running back to my desk to answer phones or having to go get everyone lunch. I barely learned anything. Thankfully, they left us all detailed binders for the new system. I cannot tell you the hours I spent going through that binder. Since I was used to purchasing, my GM decided I would be the only person to use the system to create requisitions to be approved by him for purchase orders. My GM promised this was my way into a company position. He said come the new year it would be a done deal. New Year's comes and goes without a word. I finally approached him about it, but he just shrugged and said he still didn't have approval from corporate. After a year and a half, I needed health insurance for duck sakes. Within 2 months, our shipping manager was leaving the company. Higher ups decided I would be the perfect person to resume his position, as well as continue my normal duties, till they hired a new shipping manager. For a $2 raise for even though he made 4 times what I made. I was a bit pissed, but I had already drained so much into this company I didn't want to leave just yet. Shipping manager has me trained to take his job after a couple of days. On his last day, things just felt odd. My GM was acting ironically nice that morning, seeing how I was scrambling to do 2 jobs at once. At noon I went to lunch, but upon my return Dickface VP from corporate was there. Apparently while I was at lunch, my GM left the company, pre-planned with corporate, and Dickface VP was there to act as interim till we found a new GM. But why is VP a dickface, you might ask? He is the person responsible for company position being rejected. It was hell, but after a month they finally hired a new shipping manager. Dickface VP was barely ever there since he lived about 5 states away. Which meant all the managers basically stopped doing their jobs. They were so negligent our company failed its yearly audit, nearly losing our biggest customer. But finally I got my company position with an okay salary. Really only a $1 more than my previous hourly rate, but I wasn't about to complain. Unfortunately, things only got worse. Many of managers decided to take advantage of the lack of supervision and soon begin dumping their responsibilities on me. I did my best to help them, but it was just too much. I sent an email to corporate HR about what was happening. She returned my email saying she would make a detailed list of my responsibilities so I could share it with the managers when they put their jobs on me. But she never bothered to make the list. Dick Face VP comes to town a week later and it's annual review day. My review went fine, but when I tried to speak with him about the managers, he shut the conversation down quickly. I didn't want to push it, so I let it at that. The managers never stopped pushing their responsibilities on me. But now my situation had changed altogether. My husband got a great job for a local union and I no longer needed to work. My husband was more than supportive of me leaving the company to be a stay-at-home mom. Especially since we were about to start trying for a second child. I didn't leave immediately, but what I did do was keep all plant supplies at the lowest threshold I could. And then I quit. No notice. No call. Nothing. Now the pro revenge occurs when they realize I really had quit and not one person there had any clue how to use the purchasing system. They called me so many times. Call from the office, block. Call from quality manager cell, block. Call from plant supervisor cell, block. I blocked everyone except for the CSM who was my friend. She told it took 2 days before they were able to order anything, with the help of someone from corporate. The plant machine didn't run for over a day because of it. Every hour the machine is down, they lose thousands of dollars. And this revenge cost them just that. Thanks for listening.